They're bitchy, though.
They're what?
They're two of her are bitchy.
I don't like her touching the radio, so they're almost too smart.
Her old man is pretty smart, to be lazy. So,
he's blind.
The times when I've been bossed the most, one time I was walking along, they're so agile too. I was walking along on the side of the road, and it was around rush hour traffic. Stepped on a palm frond that had been out for like a month, so it was crunching, and it crunched, and all of a sudden, I looked down, and there's no horse underneath me. I'm just falling on the ground. The horse dropped the crunch, and I just into our rush hour traffic. But fortunately, it turned the corner before going into rush hour traffic and went back to the stable. We had to walk back.
And we live out in Hadleburg, so there's a lot of, the bigger ones. We love riding our bikes. We rode to my friend's farm, or where I came from.
Now
we're like getting ready to ride
that. Hi, girl. Nice to meet you.
One of them's got a rider, and the other one's going down. So they're going down south. So like 5 minutes from here on the side. Barely down, like the hell out of the way. And we thought everything was fine. I ran to go get like one of the people that came here, had a hearing in the park of them, but now I'm just getting by the time I turned back around, it's the first rider. And both of us had then down the road comes a truck yelling at the guy, get in the back of the truck. And I don't know what happened. They were not small, and they were, I think, the one that was the
yes, good to meet you. I'm glad that we met up.
I had one horse that I was, is that a pulley? I was leaping a horse. It was a thoroughbred.
I love that.
Here's the deal is all of a sudden it went into a full out gallop, and I turned into his head and tried to get him to any rubber net. He was turning like this and still pull it.
Oh,
and I was, oh crap. And then I thought, you know what? I can't control this horse, and it's not gonna stop. And I thought
Oh my god, I can tell my friends.
They kind of got me out.
Okay, I don't know if you told them this is all my favorite stuff.
I told them they were playing the Smiths. I love it.
They were playing Hush before that. They were playing Dymox. And they played a church song that wasn't Under the Milky Way. And yeah.
Oh,
awesome. There's Reptiles. Do you like that kind of thing? Do you like New Wave stuff?
Yeah, New Wave or alternative rock.
My friend Eddie, he's the singer for a band called The Cactus, who's kind of a soft cell kind of sound, but most of the time he's a promoter and DJ for on the stage. There's a bunch of LA and Mexican Smiths coming up. And they are amazing.
Really?
He's bringing one. I want to say it's the second. He generally has my grips with Don Osborne. I go for him regularly. He does a Britpop kind of alternative night at
Grips.
Yeah, Grips. There's like a big arrow, big 50s arrow. Grips. Yeah. Like North Park one on the stage. But yeah, it's really awesome. And then on
whenever he can. You were doing exactly what I was looking for, Eileen. I was looking for the dry erase. I'm gonna be using this one.
All
right, are you ready to stream?
Already streaming.
Already streaming. All right. Let's go ahead and get started. All right. I hope everyone here in this area is for Arizona WordPress Meetup. If you're not, you're still welcome here. We're not kicking anyone out. But this is the meetup group. My name is Carol Stanbaugh, and I'm the organizer of the Chandler Arizona WordPress Meetup. And I'm happy to have you guys all here. I would like to go around and just do a quick introduction of the different people that are here.
Did everybody get what the password was? Because I just erased it.
If you are new to Gangplank and need to log in, the password is walk the plank. Walk the plank. And if you are new to the meetup and are tweeting, use the hashtag WPAZ for tweets. If you are watching through live stream and you have a question, use the hashtag WPAZ, and we will answer that hashtag. Answer those questions through Twitter. So it's great to have you all here. Let's go around and just introduce ourselves and say who you are, what you do, and what level you are at as far as WordPress knowledge. My name is Carol Stanbaugh. I'm the principal of a freelance business called Tech Tools.
Hashtag WPAC.
Sorry.
There's a little delay there. And I've been using WordPress for about 3 years, and I consider myself power user, advanced user, beginning developer. So.
I'm Lisa. I'm here to write things, and I know nothing, and I'm going to turn letters to you.
That's not true.
I'm Diane Serbaum, graphic designer. I'm pretty beginner user just because I've kind of run some roadblocks, but I'm hoping to get past that.
I'm Chris Diamond. I own a company called Hogfish Studios. We do WordPress development and WordPress website maintenance.
My name is Justin Tucker. I'm a backend developer. I build themes for a living. I've been doing it for like 5 years or so. And I run my own freelance business.
I'm Chuck Agewood, basically retired. I do websites for basically motorcycle organizations, so most of it's free gratis. I've been working with WordPress for probably since 2008.
Hi, I'm Kelly Harsney. This is my first time here, and I'm new to WordPress. I want to start a blog.
I'm Rebecca. I have been here for about 5 or 6 months, but I still consider myself a very new beginner with WordPress. And
I'm Sandy Masters, and I have a website called Academy, and it's for the classroom. And I've been using WordPress since 2012.
I'm Jeff Shady. I'm a freelance WordPress consultant. I'm building a network of sites. One of them includes AnthemGarageSales.com. It's built on the BuddyPress platform. And I'm here tonight to do the presentation for Zach.
Yay!
I'm Felix Gordischer. I've been a PHP developer for over a decade, but right now I am the software development manager for WordPress at GoDaddy, and just their network.
I am Alexandria Starr, and I've been coming to this meetup for about last year. I've been to two WordCamps now.
Yay!
And I actually am I guess I would consider myself to be a fairly advanced user. And I've had WordPress since about 2008. And so what I started coming here is I wanted to, because I do the user end of it, that I wanted to learn more about how to install and set up and design my own, so that I could do some of the websites. So that's kind of good.
I'm Libby Johan. I'm Gitara. I'm new with the WordPress. It's the first time for me.
Okay.
I'm Rohit Johan. I'm a beginner with WordPress. I'm trying to develop a site for a discussion group on things like consciousness, self-development, etc. And I also want to use this site for affiliate marketing for related products.
Okay. My name is Karina. I'm new to WordPress, and it's my first time coming to the workshop, so I'm here to learn.
Yay! Yep.
I'm Cliff, and I like coming to meet up so I can wear my WordCamp sweat.
I'm Myra. I occasionally blog, and I work for the blog.
I'm Micah, and I'm building a WordPress site for my department.
Dan, I'm a designer developer. I've been working with WordPress for about 3 years now. We're focusing on the last year, freelancing.
Hi, Lee. I'm a content creator freelance, and my website is
scienceer.com.
Thank you.
Says the GoDaddy guy.
She's a chief.
I had that shirt design. I'm quite proud of it.
WP Outlaw hashtag.
Oh, really cool shirt.
He's a chief volunteer wrangler.
And I just want to say, even though I'm wearing a WP shirt, I do have some. I do sorry, some business with GoDaddy.
GoDaddy swag too.
What are you stepping up to?
I got questions.
Freebies.
Jeremy.
Yeah, I'm Jeremy. I've been working with WordPress since 2008, I guess. 2007, 2008. I'm owner of WebGuys, WordPress shop, and I come here every time. I'm here for a reason. I have nowhere else to go. Oh. Yeah. No, I'm really involved in WordPress.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I help out.
That's, I come here to hang out with you.
Sorry?
Oh, hi. I'm Lauren. My company name is Creative Harvest. I'm a graphic designer. I come from the print world, and I love WordPress.
Oh, hi, I'm Mara, and I'm a WordPress book developer. I've been doing it for about 5 years, and I work for a company called Positive Development, doing web development and design. Oh.
Awesome. All right, so, whoa, that was loud. Chris, I'm going to be over here for a while, so if you want to get the stream coming this way. So, this is a, how many people are here for the first time and you came to WordCamp? Because it seemed like there were a lot of people who are coming here on the heels of WordCamp. Maybe not as many as I thought. I thought there was going to be a lot of newbies come from WordCamp. But what I still want to do is very relevant. I want to take this first 30 minutes, and I want to really use you guys and figure out what it is that you need and you want from this meetup. And we're going to kind of springboard off of where we just came from, which was an awesome WordCamp, led by April, who's not here yet. She will be here a little bit later. Anyway, so what I first want to do is we're going to capture some of the topics and some of the things that you liked most and gained most from WordCamp. How many? First of all, let me see a raise of hands. How many went to WordCamp? So a huge number of people. My apologies for those of you who did not go, but we will get there. We will get to you in a sec. So tell me, what is it that you liked about WordCamp? What did you take away from it? Yes?
WooCommerce is awesome.
WooCommerce.
Vagrants?
Yes.
I was a volunteer coordinator, and I
want to
say all of you
are
awesome.
I want to say that Eileen was an awesome volunteer coordinator.
She was.
She really was. She was amazing. Thank you, Eileen.
Well, thank all of you who made it possible.
Because there were a lot of you in here. How many people volunteered? Chuck was here. Yeah. Look at this. Yeah. Our meetup is, it really came through for us. So thank you for volunteering. All right. What else? What was good about WordCamp?
The food.
The food. All right. Well, you know what? Maybe I can figure out a way to feed you once or twice here.
I particularly like the day of business on Sunday. And
yes.
Specifically Troy Dean's presentation.
Yeah,
Troy Dean is a rock star, isn't he? Yes.
If you didn't go
if
to his thing, then other people were talking about him in the panel.
Well, someone tweet right now that at Carol Stanbaugh said at Troy Dean is a rock star. And do hashtag WPAZ. If someone will do that for me, I would appreciate it. Troy's a great guy, and yes, he has some great messages with regard to kind of the business part, the business end of WordPress. And it doesn't even have to be WordPress. It's about running a business. All right. Anyone else? What was good? Yes.
I said it was like welcoming and open for a beginner as well as someone who's very, very advanced. I did not feel out of place.
Okay.
So that was very good.
Okay. So you felt welcome to despite your level.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I loved meeting all the people from our community. There were a lot of local people who came out that... you know, we hadn't gotten to meet at the meetups, and there was a lot of good networking and just development of relationships,
really. Relationships and social. The social part of it, all right? Definitely.
Yeah, I like the party.
The party was awesome.
The party was really good.
The party was great.
And the wine and design was really nice.
That was awesome.
The wine and design, wasn't that neat?
That was awesome.
Was that AIGA or was that like a...
AIGA was our partner sponsor on that, yes. And they did a fantastic job. Yeah. The parties were great. The wine and design was really neat.
I'll tell you, I liked the way that you guys separated it this year in terms of... levels.
Okay.
It made it kind of, I know you did it last year, but it just seemed different this year, that it was more scaled down for the beginners.
Okay, so the content with your beginner was a little bit more beginner-like, okay?
Yeah.
We actually knew to do that, because we really read those evaluations that you guys do. I know they're long evaluations, but we read them and we pay attention.
They didn't have as much variety about different angles of things to do this year as opposed to the year before.
Mm-hmm.
But like I said, my favorite was that WooCommerce. It was like, oh my gosh, you know, I didn't know about it. And,
opened your eyes.
It really opened
stuff.
My eyes.
Awesome.
To how easy it was to
mm-hmm.
see the actual back end of it.
Mm-hmm.
By comparison, I used OpenPart, and that was like the easiest until now. This one's coming out.
Right. Excellent. Yes.
Yeah, I was going to say, one of the sessions I attended was by the lawyer. I don't remember her name.
Oh, Ruth Carter.
Yes. I found that very interesting,
yes.
And particularly for blogging.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep, she's great.
I liked the design track.
Okay.
I learned some things that I didn't, that, you know, I needed to start to focus on. But compared to, I didn't go to last year, but I went to the year before that.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, the splitting off was a whole lot nicer because the first time I went, it was all programmers and all brand new, mostly bloggers. There was nothing for designers who want to be more developy, and
right.
This time was a lot better with that.
Right, yeah. Yeah, April April snuck that on Jeremy. Jeremy was the one that handled the Friday events, and she said, guess what, Jeremy, I'm adding a track. And he was a champ, and he went with it and said, okay, let's add a track. So I think that was a good addition.
Yeah. I think that the business thing on Sunday was really good. I came, even though
a plus one for that.
Yeah, I because I think that that's kind of applicable to either being in that business, knowing, because I'm a user, I'm a business person, but knowing how the designers and developers, how they're looking at us. And I think that if you put some more, maybe next year, think about doing more businessy stuff, appealing more to business people that are also doing their web design, which would kind of put them at the intermediate or advanced kind of level.
Okay.
But I would find that useful.
Okay.
All for clients for all different kinds of projects is people going, I want a word, I want a site, or I want a blog, or I want social media, but they really important.
Right.
And there were at least two seminars that I went to.
Yep. Content can be the hardest part. It really can. It can be what really slows down the site. All right. Any other lights? Yes.
Saturday,
all in one location. You know, and that's a logistical thing, and it's dependent upon like what locations are available to us. So that is, but we concur, fully agree that being all in one location. I think we did a organizers wrap up meeting last week. And that was, everyone was in very much agreement the same way. So being all together. And that also kind of lends a little bit to the social part of it, the social. Okay. All right, so, yes.
The last comment that I want to make is about the sponsors.
Okay.
We had some awesome, a lot of sponsors this year.
We did. You can thank @NatHandler for working to get all of those amazing sponsors, which included GoDaddy, WP Engine, SiteGround, a ton of great people that were there.
The
@NatHandler.
It was really cool.
So, yeah, and I think that the sponsors appeared to have a good time too with the.
It was a long weekend, but yes.
There were a lot of hosting sponsors, and I think that says something about the WordPress economy, like the landscape of WordPress right now.
I just had a quick correction on
yes.
that. His Twitter is @VerandaGroup.
@VerandaGroup. All right.
Oh, yeah.
So if you give a shout out to
I'm sorry, Vendara.
Vendara. V-E-N.
D-A-R-A.
D-A-R-A. And is it group too? @VenderaGroup is his Twitter. Okay. All right. So, yeah, if you give a shout-out to Nat, he certainly deserves it because he wrangled the sponsors and got some great people in, and without them we wouldn't have had such a good, amazing event. Yeah.
The sponsors, some of the people were not necessarily sponsors, but they were just wandering around. If you just took a rest and sat somewhere, that's how I got that WPMU that I sent you about. I was just sitting someplace, and this guy's like, hey, I've been sent here to give somebody a free year subscription. Do you want it?
Wow.
So just
that's
like
a deal.
Yeah, that is a deal. WPMU is that's
is
a
it really?
Yeah, it is.
So let's get me good at that.
Yeah. Well, and that goes back to networking again, a plus one for the networking and the social. You hear a lot of people who go to WordCamps all the time, you'll hear them talking about the WordCamp that happens in the halls. And it's not necessarily the WordCamp that happens in the sessions, which is actually very good. There's a lot of WordCamp that happens in the halls. And that is meeting people, getting introduced to people. If you're a big development shop looking to hire someone, you find people to hire. If you're looking for work, or even if you're just looking for good plugins, you exchange stories, and that's a huge deal. All right, so now, if there's nothing else, I would like to shift everything that we've talked about all the great stuff that happened at WordCamp. And as the meetup organizer, what I want to do is have a discussion and figure out what we can do as the meetup organizers to continue to deliver some of that goodness. Now, it's obviously not going to be in near the way or the scale that 750 people and a massive party at City Hall is going to do.
We can't do that every month.
Can't do that every month. So, so sorry. But what I want to do is take, okay, so what were the things, what were the keys that we talked about there? We talked about networking, and I may have Lisa go back to her phone and kind of spit back from the pictures that she has had on her phone. And let's think about recurring themes that we can take from that and that we can move into the meetup. I heard a couple of social, and so I want to know, is social important here? Whenever we plan the meetup groups, we have the agenda pretty set. We do 6:30 to set, you know, we have it set, and at 8:30 we conclude. And for pretty much that whole time, we are learning something or having a presentation. So my question to you is that good? Does it need to change? Do we need to now, you know, think about, oh, well, every other month or even every month, let's have, start at 6:30, but agenda starts at 7, and 6:30 is snacks and milling around and talking to each other. I don't know. It's always hard to do networking at the beginning because no one knows each other. It seems like networking works better at the end. Yeah. But like maybe 6:30 to 8. Cut off at 8. 8's milling around talking because that's valuable. So, I mean, I don't know. Those are the kinds of things. I want you to think about what we just talked about with successful in WordCamp. Then I want to hear what you guys think we can harness and channel into the meetup.
I have one suggestion.
Okay.
And this goes back to the beginning.
Okay.
You know, we've got some brand new.
Uh-huh.
And I think that there should be like a little standard little thing that we can tell the brand newbies where to start. Because I know that this was over my head with a lot. I learned a lot,
mm-hmm.
but I wasn't able to actually take that on and do anything with it.
Right.
Until I actually installed the WordPress
right.
site. And I think it took 6 months last year to get to that place.
Yeah.
So there's another little place, like the WordPress.com,
mm-hmm.
I think is a really good place for people to start to have no experience.
Okay. So on our meetup site, and Lori and I worked super hard to put this together, but I am guilty about not directing people to it. And actually, do you know where it is, Lisa, on the website? Okay, it's on meetup.com. If you sit down at meetup.com, Lisa is totally my Vanna White, isn't she?
Oh my gosh. I'm gonna do a hip twist. You want to do that?
So meetup is right on the tab next door. First tab, there you go. Yeah, I've got it open. So if you go into meetup.com and if you go up to pages at the top, and if you scroll down, we have some, in this where it is, Lori?
Yes.
Resources for noobs. Where is it?
I have resources for developers. It might only be showing some because there's a lot more pages.
Because you're not logged in.
Okay. Am I not logged in? Oh, log in.
She's like, I don't know your password.
Well, she has a password.
I can't remember it. I can't All remember right. my 18-character password.
Okay, so we're not going to be able to show you the exact page, but if you go to Pages and if you're logged in, you should be able to see. Although I'm confused as why Chuck's is showing up from 2011. I don't know. Lori, if you have yours, if you could kind of look at it and see if you can find it.
Yeah,
summer probably marked as public. And some
probably. Oh, yeah.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, that's true. Some of those may just be marked as public, so if you sign in. Which brings me to another point. This more, right before we started Meetup, we were at 998 WordPress Meetup members. So if there are two of you who are in this room who are not members of the Meetup, please go sign up now so we can get 1,000 for the end of the day. But if you are logged in, just like David did, hopefully we'll be able to get in, and yes, there we go. And it's the resources for beginners or for newbies.
Yes.
Scroll down.
It should be down.
He's doing that. There's only one there.
Yeah, Lori, I'm not seeing it either. Ah.
It's under Pages?
It's under Pages.
Is it more?
Yeah.
Why is it going to the other side?
See all pages. There it is. Resources for the newbie, right there.
Okay.
So this has a lot of information on it. That mouse is acting weird. That has stuff for newbies. So what I need to do...
On the WordPress, do a link from the WordPress.org.
Yeah, we should do that. We should put a link on there from our page. Can one of my co-organizers make a note for me? Put a link on our self-hosted site to make sure and highlight the newbie page. Or to link to the newbie page. We may even want to copy that information and put it over on the self-hosted. There's nothing secret about that. All of that stuff is really good information. So we do have some stuff on our meetup site. We haven't been as good about telling people about it. So maybe that, I mean, that's a great suggestion, because we do want to, someone over here said that we were welcome to all levels, and that's what we want to do. We do not want to be just one or the other. We really do want to be welcome to all levels. All right. So what other things can we take from what was good at WordCamp? Swing it over. Yeah.
One of the biggest problems that I have is the roadblocks that I'm always talking about. Mm-hmm. Making sure your server, you know, if you're hosting with somebody or if you're hosting with, you know, a big company like GoDaddy, making sure that all the permissions are available for you to be able to upload things.
Okay.
The other thing that at least two of the different seminars talked about, but I'd like to talk a little bit more about, is talking about how great certain themes are and how certain theme companies are really great, but it still gets to the point where you see the demo, and then when you install it, it doesn't look anything like that.
That's such a common problem. It's a very common issue to have that theme not look the same, because you've got to do configuration to the theme when you load it. For example, it's when you put in a Genesis theme and you load it, it looks nothing like until you get the front page widget, because it's all widgetized.
You can import some of that stuff there.
You can, yeah.
If you know how to do that.
So that's a good thing to learn is, okay, so capturing on that, shortcuts, tips, and tricks for how to install theme and get it to look like the demo. Yes? Yay! 1,000 members! So two questions on that. One said a rock star bar, and I've actually wondered if we want a mini rock star bar on occasion here at our meetups. Would that be helpful? It's a little harder because we're a smaller group, and that would mean someone would be leaving and all that. And then number two, the idea that you had is like a mini jam session or a mini just hack session. And a lot of people associate the word hack with, well, you have to know how to software program or whatever hack. No, you don't. You can have a little hack table over here that's learning how to put together pages, and you can have a hack table over here that's learning how to modify a plugin. What do you think about? And now that would be more like just a group hack, and we don't have any programs. Would you come to a session that was just a group hack? And we'll divide up into groups, and we'll have people who are, I mean, like, I'm looking around the room right now. I see in the room the people that could help lead a different table of different things sitting right here.
If you did like you do, where you send the agenda and saying we're going to have group hacks on these topics,
okay,
that would be great, as long as we know what's coming up.
So you would want to know the topic of the group hack.
Yeah.
Because that's one of those things that would be a which came first, the chicken or the egg. Because what if we have a group hack for someone who wants to modify a plugin, but everyone who comes, no one cares about modifying a plugin. It would almost be like...
An unconference.
It would be an unconference almost. We get here, we have everyone write on a piece of paper what they want to hack on. They come up, say, here's my hack. This would go real fast. If you've ever gone to an unconference, we would do it super fast. And then we would take the top ones and split them off, and we would just go work.
Okay.
How does that sound? Would you guys come to something like that?
Yeah.
Would you?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
You could do one common thing and then have everything else
unconference. Mm-hmm. Yep.
What does that mean,
unconference? It's a certain way that some conferences are run where there is no agenda, and you get there and the agenda is made by the people who are there. Okay. And so that's what an unconference is. A hack is just people, like, making stuff.
Doing stuff.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. When I first came to this group and they used the word hack, I only had one thing in mind. Breaking into a company. that's all I thought the work was used for.
Let's do that next time.
No, let's don't.
But I'm just wondering how many other people have that same concept.
That's
because outside of here, that's
right.
Kind of what we think.
I think the nature of that word has really changed in the last 5 years.
More than that.
What did you say, David?
I said it's a misconception.
Yes.
Yeah, I think it is a misconception. And I would agree. That's kind of why I said a hack doesn't mean you have to be, you know, doing any heavy duty hot, you know. It can be that you're just working on a project. Is it still a hack project for Hack Night? Is that thing still going to work sometime?
Yeah.
So the gorilla back there is going to be a Hack Night project, and they're making it do something with Arduino, I believe. So, I mean, that's what a hack is. A hack is building something.
Well,
sometimes it's useful, sometimes it's not useful. It doesn't matter. You hack it and you have fun.
What are we calling those mods?
I don't know.
Modifications?
Yeah, modifications.
Like people do that to their DVR or their
Yeah, exactly. So having a hack night as one of ours would be a good thing. Maybe not all the time, but once a quarter, every 6 months or something. All right, I'm seeing kind of good on that. Any other things that we can take forward?
Parties?
Yeah,
parties in City Hall.
Parties in City Hall. I don't know about City Hall. But anyway, what about parties? I mean,
there are a lot of meetups that do have a social conflict.
Exactly. And so that we've always been very educationally focused. Now, some of us will stay around and we'll go out for drinks afterwards, so we get our social in that way, and that's good too. But, I mean, we had last May, when WordPress turned 10, we had a birthday party here. And we played silly games. We had the Wiki Wars.
Yeah.
Remember the Wiki Wars? That got intense. That was pretty funny. So, I mean,
Speaking of your Wiki Wars, I go to the InDesign user group, and they have raffles. Now, they're sponsored by Adobe, and that's a bunch of money. But they usually have a local sponsor come in, and they provide food, which I don't think that's necessary. But if people were up for it, whatever. Like you said, the wiki thing, like at the beginning, he hands out extra raffle tickets when he asks you a trivia question about the software.
Okay.
And if you can answer it.
Okay. We would definitely need another organizer. Now, everything that I'm talking about here, this is all a volunteer-driven organization. Every single one of the people you see helping out here does not get paid a dime for what we do. And so what I want to do is also solicit people. It's like, oh, well, I could help get some sponsorships and do raffles. You know, I could do this part, maybe get some donated food for parties, or I could do this. So this group is our group. This group is this group here. Not the organizers group. So if there's something like that we want to do, I say let's go for it. Now let's figure out, okay, who can we get to help take that lead on, and let's do that. So if you have any ideas, because we are going to need some additional help if we're going to pull some of this really cool stuff off. So think about that. So socialize and just maybe having a party. Yes?
The thing that I'm interested in is the hack, people hacking together and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, it doesn't require you to be a developer, anything, you know, WordPress related to be involved in coding and designing and, you know, understanding management. Any skill can be applied to that project. So I know we've talked about passing on
thing.
Yep, that's in the process. Yeah, I'm still working with Skyhook and some of the developers, and we're going to put together a hack for that. We will definitely advertise it to the group. Now, that's going to be a very specific hack because it's going to be a part of CampTix and WordPress.org. And so it has to be, like, we're going to have some of the WordCamp and automaticians available to make sure that we're doing everything exactly right.
Right.
So it's going to be a little bit more of a structured hack because it has to be.
It's something that we're bringing instead of doing. I know right now we've got enough, like,
Yeah. And that's another way of giving back, you know, giving back to the community through a new thing. All right, so topics. Let's talk about topics. Going in the new year, what are the new topics that you, I heard WooCommerce. Someone said, yay, love WooCommerce. Was there something else that you heard at WordCamp that you'd like to hear more about? Yes.
Definitely the business end of WordPress.
Business
and,
end?
Like how to price, how to quote, how to bring
your
product into
scope,
those kinds of things.
Okay.
So,
topics, business.
Like a
generalized
business proposals?
Yeah.
Like the business of WordPress.
Okay.
So maybe one meetup a quarter could be dedicated to that.
Maybe one meetup a quarter is really for business users. Now one thing that I want to...
Costing too?
Bidding, scope, defining scope, staying in scope.
It's like the topics that we always come back to are like security, e-commerce.
Yeah.
The question gets asked at almost every meetup. And I think those of us have been doing it a little while, we're starting to really get into the business part.
We want to go do the business. All right.
What about troubleshooting?
Troubleshooting workshop is going to be in April.
Oh, okay.
Already got that planned. It's going to be fun.
What criteria, how to pick a theme. Like,
how to pick a theme?
You know, like the critical thinking skills of what your client is asking for and then how you translate that.
Okay.
How to interview a customer, maybe? Yeah, that's ideal.
That is a great one. And picking a theme, that's kind of, April did a lot of that last year when we did the strategy. We did that whole thing about strategy and the information architecture and user experience.
And then another thing we get a lot of questions about are plugins. We talk about it in tips and tricks. And like, there are
So I had an idea on plugins. Tell me what you guys think about this. There have been times whenever I wanted to play with a plugin, but let's face it, we're all busy. And like, there's about 10 different plugins I would love to install in a sandbox and play with, and I never do. What if we had a cube, like a plug-in sandbox cube for the WordPress meetup, and one person every month speaks up and says, I'll take X plug-in and put it in the sandbox this month and play with it, and I'll show it to you next month. And then someone else then the next month says, okay, I want to know about this plugin, and someone else says, I'll take that into Sandbox and play with it, and I'll report back. What do you guys think about that?
Yeah. Basically, what you're saying is have a presentation on a plugin each time.
Right. Have a
And I like that.
Yeah, have a presentation
like
on a plugin.
More than that here.
That's something we've been doing up at Scottsdale, and it goes over very well.
Okay.
So everyone really, we do like my favorite plugins, but I think extending that to just an educational, like, hey, even if it's not your favorite, go try it.
Right.
And you know, we can report back and have
Cliff did business directories a couple of months ago, where he actually took two of them. Last summer, he took two of them and he compared them. And so that kind of got me thinking about, because he actually spent some work on it. So it's not like if you were the one that says, I'll do it, there's a little bit of commitment to it, because you got to take it, you got to go play with it, you got to be ready to present. But I think that would help us all, because then whenever the next time you're looking for a solution, it's like, I remember seeing, and then we can even have them on our list, and we can make sure and keep them up there.
Or maybe we should do a survey on what type of plugins most people are looking for.
Well, and that was my next question, is to find out what plugins are going to be in this queue. We need to do a survey on our website, and I can put a form up on the website. I'm going to show you guys the website in just a second. I can put a form up on the website, and everyone can put in, I want to learn about X plugin. And you guys can just tell us, what are your top plugins you want to learn? That will be our plugin queue. And next month, we'll start drawing, and someone will do that.
Not necessarily a plugin, but a type of plugin.
Right.
So I want to learn, I need a forum plugin.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
that way
you could find one and then you could find a better one.
Yeah.
You don't want to present on the other one.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
It would be useful. I can provide you guys data on what plugin that most people have in order.
Extremely useful. Yes. Can you email that to me? All right.
That was part of our video at work.
Yes. Yeah.
So
I
have
that.
All that data for you.
Yay. Awesome. Love our partners. Isn't that awesome? Our sponsors keep on giving back. All right. So this is really, really helpful. I don't know about the other organizers who are in the room here, but just having this and being able to really get this feedback from you is amazing. Thank you so much. One thing I did want, it's been a while since we've highlighted our website, and so I just want to show you guys the website so that you can know. So this is the website that we have, and on the website here, if you go under WPAC, we've got suggested topic and show and tell. So if you go to suggest a topic, you don't have to know how to be, I mean, like, you don't have to know the topic to suggest it. You could say, I want to find more information about. If you click yes, you are knowledgeable about the topic and would like to present, then we're going to ask you a little bit more information. But you don't have to know about it. Just use this form and tell us what it is that you guys want to know. Because that's what this meetup is all about, is meeting the community's needs. There's also a form right here, which is the show and tell form. And the show and tell form is what we've done in the past where a member does a show and tell and they show their site. But I'm thinking that show and tell may be replaced with this whole plug-in sandbox queue idea. Just because I think that would be a different, we've been doing show and tell for a while. We can come back to that in a year or so. Well, then we lose, if we do both of those, then we don't ever have time for an actual presentation. So, if we have a topic, like to do a show and tell, a plug-in review, tips and tricks, and a topic, and we want to have 30 minutes to network, we've run out of time. So we may go away from the show and tell for a little while and do the whole plug-in queue.
We can alternate one month.
Sure.
The nice thing about show and tell is that it does sometimes shows plugins.
Mm-hmm. It does. It
shows what a plugin does on an actual site. It shows design and it can show some business and content.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is how, I mean, so if you ever want to suggest a topic or show and tell, I'm also going to design a gravity form that will go in here that will be about the plugin. It'll be the plugin sandbox. So I'll say, what plugin do you want to see? Are you willing to put it in the sandbox and play with it? And what's your name? So I'll add one of those to here. Will someone send me an email and remind me to do that? Someone who's in a computer, because if I don't write it down, I won't do it. All right. So service providers, this is a business directory we have. I don't know that we have it built out very much, but you can see, oh my goodness, I'm not even on there yet. Yay, because I need to add myself to it. But this is a service provider business directory of the developers in the WordPress shops. And the discussion forum actually links over to the message board. This is another thing I wanted to highlight. We haven't used this lately, and there's not been a lot of activity on it, but this is a very good place for people to ask questions and to get questions answered. And there's some great people who will answer questions on this discussion board. So if you ever have any need for the discussion forum, come here. I believe that's the main thing that I wanted to show you about. We're planning on at some point getting these lessons that we record put into an LMS. That's a giant, bigger job, and I think a lot of us who are already involved are pretty full with our jobs, so if anyone's interested in taking some of the content we have and putting it into LMS, we'd love to have you. And here's the recordings in the YouTube channel, because whenever we do the meetup, we do the Google Hangout and record it. So, and here's the information about the local meetups. So that's really what I just wanted to show you and talk about today. Thank you so much for, like, indulging me and not, you know, we didn't have a formal presentation. Jeff, do you want to go ahead and come up and get set up? Are you okay with using this computer, or do you want your own?
Yeah, I got all my password and stuff.
Okay. All right. So we need to get, and does anyone have a dongle? My dongle, yeah, it's the USB to VGA, or the Thunderbolt to VGA, I think, is what he's going to need.
I might have one.
I've got, it's in my backpack over there, if no one else does. Yay, got it. All right. So we'll get Jeff hooked up over here on this.
Hey, there's this.
Let's do tips and tricks right now. So any tips and tricks? For those who are new to the group, this is where we ask, we share something that's really neat or that we've discovered and we want other people to know, or if you have a question and a need, you ask for help. So any tips and tricks?
I bought a subscription to lynda.com this month, and I had a subscription like 6 years ago, and oh my gosh, it is awesome.
Lynda.com.
Yeah, $25 a month, or give yourself a gift for the whole year. Everything you can imagine. Like, I found things on how to do a Facebook contest giveaway, what the tips are. There's another one with like 10 minute videos of just, you can do this, you can do this. Just all different, it affects web, it affects business strategy, Adobe products. I initially went on there to learn more about QuickBooks. There's just so much information
there. I have it too.
Wonderful. Very cool. Lynda.com.
Is that L-I-N-D-A?
L-Y.
And even if you feel like you have to, maybe if you can't afford it for a month or two, you can call them and put it on hold, but you'll still be on their mailing list, and they'll still tell you, I don't know, once a week, all the new things they've got. They've got a lot more business stuff out there if you're interested in that. I've been spending the last 2 days brushing up on e-publications because I'm trying to do that and WordPress at the same time. But yeah, I agree. Lynda.com is so great.
One of the tips they gave was to put a YouTube video on your, instead of grabbing all the embedded code up for your YouTube, you simply go to your page and you plot the page, the URL, and it shows up.
In WordPress,
yep. I
have
to see if that worked responsively.
Not sure. They started that a couple of versions ago on WordPress. All you have to have is the URL to do it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool feature.
You put that like in like a gallery area or a media area?
It's in any content. Yeah, in any like content area.
It'll just automatically.
If you just put the URL, it will. You don't have to have the embed code. Yep.
I don't have a question. I had a question, not a solution. On my website, there's a fair amount of proprietary material. All my content is all in there. And I want to protect it. In other words, I don't want people to be copying it without giving their name and email address.
Okay.
How do I do that?
How do you protect content on the website so people can't copy it? Scraping. It's scraping. That's a good question. I'd love to hear what people say. And actually, Joe Manna just walked in. Hello, Joe.
Hey.
And he's a content guy, and he would be an awesome person.
Sure.
I don't know if you've heard that question.
How do you protect
content from someone scraping it?
Well, membership sites. There's membership site software out there, like plugins that do that.
Mm-hmm.
You can use passwords for your posts if it's, like, super private. About it.
Is that it? So
once it's out there, it's out there.
Once, yeah.
Yeah.
There's no surefire way. Some people have done on certain websites, but you can use a JavaScript technique to stop the control C or the copy command from working. But at the end of the day, it doesn't really
What we've been saying,
some
yeah, what we've been saying about images for years now is, if somebody really wants your stuff, they'll find a way to get it.
They want people to look at it.
I think what he also wants is a plug-in.
Yeah,
email email me list plug-in.
Wishlist is a popular plug-in. I mean,
what?
For
wish
access
list?
Control.
Wishlist?
What's wishlist?
It's premium, but...
It's a membership plug-in.
Chris Lemma did a great post on membership plugins. You can just Google Chris Lemma membership plugins.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah.
He demystifies it.
Yeah.
No, but he wants somebody for them to sign up for his mailing list.
Okay.
Is there a plugin for that?
Well, you just I would use a Gravity form and just use whatever, like if they're using Constant Content or MailChimp, you just use the add-on for the Gravity form to get it to sync to the list. That's pretty simple.
I have a friend in a startup who... They're kind of, they work with big companies to actually protect the content they just put out there, and
uh-huh.
they kind of index the internet and look for people who have copied the text and don't do attribution, do kind of take down requests and things like that,
yeah.
if it's really sensitive content.
Do you join them as a member?
It's an expensive paid service.
Yeah,
yeah
generally big companies do it.
Even though some of the hosts are starting live streams, or watching if somebody's trying to buy a website that really shouldn't be in like
would Cloudflare do anything?
Cloudflare
would be a help.
Although I think I have heard negative things about them. I'm just saying
We use Cloudflare on all of our sites.
Yeah.
We've got, you know, probably 40 sites run through Cloudflare. And it's
yeah.
great. But the other thing I was going to say is I've been installing BetterGuppy security on a lot of sites, and you can block by IP address. You can also do that right from your HD access file.
You
right?
can block yourself
but,
out
of IP. You know, that's another option, although there's no way to tell everything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
David?
So somebody mentioned that Cloudflare program is about
yeah.
like guard or
something. Oh, no.
No, uh-uh.
Yeah, I don't
what is it?
It's a Cloudflare free tool or another thing that they try to stop people from sharing.
Okay, so Cloudflare has a Cloudflare, so C-L-O-U-D and F-L.
Called a Scrape Shield.
Scrape Shield
yeah.
from Cloudflare.
Yeah.
That's good to know about Cloudflare. A lot of us in here use that, so.
I have a clarifying question. What's the concern with scraping content? Like, is it? Are you like afraid of people stealing content and sharing it, or lowering your Google ranking? Is there like a deeper concern?
It's really for one thing, you know, what I'm putting out in my blogs is going to end up in my book later on.
Okay.
And I don't want people to be picking it out and using it before I get to use it.
So intellectual property.
Mm-hmm. So if I do want them to see them and comment on it. But I don't want them to copy and paste somewhere else. Or print it. I want
mm-hmm.
there must be somewhere that they can't print it, you know. And also I want their names so I can stay in
okay.
touch with that. It's a discussion group also.
So you're wanting a lead capture. You're wanting
lead
to capture these.
Well, yeah.
Okay. And that's that whole email Gravity form and capturing it with like, you know, whatever MailChimp or
so
or
you
whatever
you
have.
Import the plug-in Gravity forms?
You use the way I do it is you use Gravity forms.
Mm-hmm.
And Gravity Forms works automatically with MailChimp, I believe, or is there a MailChimp add-on?
Yeah.
There's also a Constant Contact add-on. You basically add that onto Gravity Forms, and it will, when someone fills out the form, it adds their name to the list on MailChimp or Constant Contact or AWeber or whatever you're using.
And Zapier.
Okay.
And wouldn't you want a copyright on your pages, too? So that
copyright on pages?
It's
not going to stop anyone, but it will legally
yeah.
For your purposes, it sounds like just capturing those people and requiring that they enter their information before they can get access to
yes,
the
right.
paywall, but
yeah, they have to know who has my information to know.
Right.
Right, yeah.
So that's, like you said, not a paywall, but a sign-up wall.
Yeah, I think you kind of kill two birds with one stone. Get more leads because you're offering an incentive for them to sign up, and at the
right.
same time you're stopping the content from just getting indexed everywhere.
Exactly.
Calling it premium content, you know.
Yeah,
by
that's what Lima, and I just found out
yeah.
that he did this whole thing on
membership plugins. Google Chris Lima and membership plugins,
yes.
And you'll get the article. Yeah.
LEMA.
Yes, Lima.
All right. So,
thank
any
you,
other
guys. Great input.
Any other tips and tricks, needs and wants?
Has anybody used Optimized Press? And do you have an opinion about it?
Optimized Press. Anyone used it? So.
I haven't used it firsthand, but someone I work with very closely used it, and they like it a lot. So it's primarily like, you know, kind of like a way to kind of increase conversions, have call to action buttons, organize content.
Squeeze pages.
Yeah, squeeze pages. Which aren't bad, and it's good to induce leads and to track it. Some of them have like connectors that optimize press to MailChimp, FusionSoft, or other things like that.
But it was legit, and we didn't have problems.
It's legit, yeah.
Great, thanks.
All right. Any other tips and tricks? All right, so I have a funny stories tip and trick. So we're going to talk about... Is it Zapier or Zapier? I've been calling it Zapier. All right. I've been calling it wrong. We're going to talk about Zapier, which like connects a lot of different stuff together. I'm excited to see Zapier. I've never seen it. I've used something called IFT. Has anyone used IFT?
Yeah.
If this, then that. IFTT.com. It is really cool. If someone tags me in a Facebook post, it automatically uploads to my Dropbox. If I take a picture with Instagram, it automatically uploads to Dropbox. If I favorite a tweet, it will save it to a Google Doc. So what it does is it connects like different things together. So if you haven't checked out IFT, IFT is just kind of fun to play with. One of my favorite they have called recipes. One of my favorite recipes that I saw is if the pollen count, so it checks the weather and pollen, if the pollen count is going to be above X number, then send me a text message and remind me to take my Benadryl. This was a real recipe on IFT. So 2 days ago, I had the bright idea. I got one of these newsletters from IFT with new recipes, and they were about Sochi Olympics. And so one of the recipes was, if the U.S. wins a gold medal, call me and sing We Are the Champions by Queen. I'm like, cool. This is awesome. So guess what? Russia is 12 hours ahead of us. 4 o'clock this morning, they were winning gold medals. So I get a phone call, and I answer it, and it's, we are the champions. And I'm like, and then I couldn't get back to sleep, and it kept ringing, so I had to get up and go to IFT and disable my recipe. So unless you're a night owl, don't use that recipe. But that's my funniest story, and that's IFT. So check IFT out. It's kind of fun.
How do you spell it?
IFTT. Three T's. IFTTT.com. All right, so our presenter tonight is going to be Jeff Shoddy. He has been a long-term member of our WordPress Meetup group. Thank you for your loyalness, for all this, your loyalty for this time. And he's going to show us some great stuff with Zapier integrations. And I am so excited about this because I've heard of it. I've heard people doing great stuff with it, but I've never seen it in action. So here we go.
Okay. Can everyone hear me all right? Perfect timing. Everything I was in, log out.
Sorry.
So, let me log back in. And, presentation here. All right. I don't know how that happened, but yeah. All right. So, who here has heard of Zapier?
Anybody? Okay, two people.
When I first heard about this, I was pretty excited. I'm always trying to think of ways to integrate WordPress with other systems, and that's pretty much what this does. It doesn't do batch processing. It does like transactional processing. So if you have, for example, a web form, be it Gravity Forms or WooFoo or some other tool, and not even a web form, it could be your invoicing application. It can take that transaction and pass it on to another application through the web. So what I wanted to do was give you a few examples of that tonight. As I was saying, Zapier, in a nutshell, is an automation tool. You build one-to-one integrations, we call them Zaps, to automate processes between applications. And one of the examples here that I thought was kind of neat was a WooFoo form to create a new lead in Salesforce. Salesforce, for me, that's pretty far out there. Not something that I use, but that is something that you could use. There are examples here. If you go to their website, they have a pretty neat directory of applications that you can work with. They list the most popular ones first. So, but for our demonstration tonight, let's take a look at, let's see, Gravity Forms. Okay, so I'll take Gravity Forms. And with that, that's not a good information. We'll do a scores. So here, if you pick Gravity Forms as your source, right, you can now pick a target application. So let's say, and all of these here are examples. So if I wanted to say Zoho Invoice, I could create a Zoho Invoice. If I wanted to do something with FreshBooks, I could integrate with FreshBooks, okay? And there are a lot of examples on here that other people have shared their Zaps. I'm a little frustrated by this sometimes because you don't always see the out-of-box integrations. You see what other people have created, which can be helpful, but if you want just the bare bones, you gotta kind of look through the list here. So they don't really identify the standard default integrations that they have. So you get an idea here. You can pick your source and your target. Another example is one of my favorites, WooFoo. I'm a big fan of WooFoo. So in there I could integrate with Aweber, Amazon AES, Basecamp. You can create project tasks. Depending on what you're capturing on your form, of course, whatever makes sense to you. So, with that, let's take a look at a demo, creating a Google contact from a Gravity Form submission. So, what do we need? What do we need to make this happen? We need a... if you're using Gravity Forms with Zapier, you need to have the developer's license, unfortunately, to get the Zapier add-on. And the developer's license, I think, is like $199. But you get all the add-ons, really. So you can integrate with some of these integrations, FreshBooks, and some of the default ones. But there's a number of them, PayPal, right? So... the other thing you need is to configure your Gravity Form to use Zapier, and I'll show you that as well. And in this example, the Google account, so you can create contact. So what I've got here is my Zapier account. I have my three Zaps created here. First one that I wanted to show you was creating a Google contact. And this is what, let me go back. This is the dashboard. You create your account, log in, you get a dashboard. And this is where you create your Zaps. So you click on Make a New Zap, and it starts you through the process. If you have time, I'll create one from scratch. In here, you can toggle your Zaps on and off. You can look at the history of how often it ran, when it ran, whether it was successful, whether there was an error. You can export this if you wanted to. And you can also copy it, rename it, share it, and remove it. Now, your subscription program in here, depending on what you subscribe to, they have different levels. I have this the lowest level right now. And it gives you a certain number of tasks and a certain number of Zaps. So I can create 20 of these Zaps here, and it will run 3,300 tasks in a month. So that's firing these triggers. I won't get into too deep on that. You can see all that in the pricing. So in this particular Zap, my source is Gravity Form, and my target is in the context. So when this happens, I think that was kind of the way they set that up. When there's a new form submission, and the other options are, that's it, the Gravity Form. So when a new form is submitted, create a contact. And that's all there is for this. And then down here, you have your webhook for your Gravity Form, which I'll show you in a sec. You have your Google account credentials. So when you set this up the first time, it's easier if you're logged into your Google account already. And it will pick that up, and it will prompt you for, yes?
What is a Google Contacts account?
Google Contacts. So let me get into the account that I want to go to. And let me know if I'm going too fast. I'm making some assumptions here. So Google has Gmail, they have contacts, they have calendars, things like that. So this is my demo contacts list for tonight. And you see I have nothing in it. If I add a new contact by hand, it looks like this.
Those contacts are coming from your Gmail account?
They can't. But in this case, we're going to send one over from a form that we fill out on the website.
Okay. But you're using the Google contact system to store it.
As the target.
Okay.
Right, so I got my website here, and I got Google contacts here, and the Zap in the middle.
Okay.
Kind of a visual way. All right. So you give it the credentials for your Google contacts. If you have any filters that you want to apply on the Gravity Form, let's say you have a drop down for urgency. If you wanted to set some values based on urgency, or if you didn't want certain values to come across, you can filter out certain criteria to do that. So down here is where you take the fields from your form and match them up with the fields to Google Contact. So let me show you the form. Right. So here's a contact me form. Right. I fill this out. I put Simpson. this particular form, actually, this particular form is. So when I hit submit on this, should looking at the right setup, put it over here. Back to the dashboard. That was the wrong form. No, that was my, I have so many forms. That was my Woofer form. So, in this one here, slide over. So everything I filled out came across. And the way I mapped this looks like duplicate data, but that's how I mapped it. And so let's look at the form real quick to show you how that worked. So who's familiar with gravity forms here? Anybody? A few of you are. For those of you who are not, this might be a little out there. And I'd be happy to meet afterwards and fill you in on anything that you have questions on. For the form, when you install Gravity Forms, there are optional add-ons that you can include. So, for example, there is a Zapier add-on. Because again, you have to have a developer's license, and you get access to all these additional add-ons. So if I go back to the form, and I go to settings, there's a, once you activate that add-on, you get this little menu option here that says Zapier. Okay? When you click on that, you get this section here. You can have multiple feeds. So if I wanted to create, if I wanted to take this one form submission and send it to 10 applications, I could do that. Right now I'm just doing a Google contact. I could send it to any of those places that I showed you examples, those different applications, you could do that. So how does this work? You give it a name that you want, all right? This webhook URL is what Zapier gives you. So if I go back to my Zapier account, dashboard, open up my Zap for the Gravity form, you'll see this webhook URL. That's the link between my form and Zapier, right? That's the website, right? So I copy that and I put it into my form setting here. It's active, yes. If I wanted conditional logic, like reason for contact is complaint, I could do something else. I could send it somewhere else, or I could not send it at all. Right? What is for customers who have any problems? So, that's the part in gravity forms. That's how you connect your form to Zappy. Right? Once I have that part, I then pick my account, and you can set up any number of accounts. If you have 10 Google contact accounts, you can add them all in here too. If you want custom filters, you can filter them here, as well as at the graphic. Okay. So, this part here is for the Google contacts. If you notice, they call them system groups. It's kind of cryptic. But if you look at these, they kind of look familiar. My contacts, friends, family, coworkers, those are circles, really, if you think about it. For those of you that are familiar with Google Contacts. So if I go back over to my contacts, those match up with what I have here pretty much. I've got my contacts. So I just picked that as where I wanted to drop the data. If I had categories, it would show the categories. If I had business contacts, I could drop them in that folder. But I'm just keeping it simple. This guy will put it all here in my contacts. So that's what that part is here. Where do you want to drop the data? Okay. So once you've selected that, and I've got my contacts is what I pick, you then map the fields. So it went and talked to my gravity form just now. Okay, it has my credentials to connect. It has the webhook. It went over there and it read the fields defined on my gravity form. So, and it even has the sample data in there from the last submission I did, so you can visually confirm, and this is a field that I want, right? So, for full name, right, which is optional, I would go name first. I'd go first name, and then I could go last name. So you can put two fields together as well. First name, similarly, pick first name, and then last name, email. And as I showed you earlier, I had the email address repeated because, just for rules, I defined that here. Other email, home email, work email. So all three of those are just dropping. And Zapier knows to pull these in. It knows when it connects to Google Contacts that these are the targets that you can drop your fields into.
Can you make any of those not optional?
No. No, they can't control any of that. You can't, if you're...
Do you know what I mean? Like, not on your end, but on the person filling out the forms?
Yes. Okay. If required fields? Yeah. And in, it's a good question. And in my case here, if I go to my form editor...
Oh, okay.
I have first and last name required. See the little asterisk there?
Yes.
For those of you not familiar with Gravity Forms, you would define that by clicking on the field and making it required in this checkbox here.
Okay.
Right? So, you map all these fields. I call them mapping. And you're creating your zap. Right? Once you do all that, you give it a name, right, and you turn it on.
What happens when you push test the zap?
Push test the zap. Good question. So it remembers previous transactions that were sent across. This here?
Yeah.
So if you click that, it pulls up sample data from previous submissions. It keeps a buffer. I don't know all the technical details of it. I just know it's kind of cool when I can do this. So the trigger sample, in this case is my gravity frame. What's in the buffer? What's hanging out there? So my last submission was what's here. So then I want to see, I want to test that. I want to push that over to my contacts again. I would click that. It sends it over. If I go over here, it should have two Homer Simpsons, which is kind of frustrating. One of the downsides to the targets that you select, and Google Contacts is one of them, and Google Docs is another. The spreadsheets, yeah. It doesn't weed out duplicates. Okay? That's because of target. It's right. How it works. Mm-hmm. So if I have a customer that fills out the form 10 times a day, I could end up with their name in here 10 times in one day. So you got to watch for that sort of thing.
In that instance, would you have a different way, like once they were a customer and once they were in your contacts, would you like have them, would there be like another Zap that you'd set up, like once somebody's in Google and they contact you, then it would go to a different email or respond a different way? Or
you could create another Zap that would trigger off of a new entry in your Google contact and then go do something. So you can chain them.
Yeah.
And there, if you go to the Zapier website, they have, in their blog, they have examples of what companies have done for their whole sales workflow, from the lead capture, the qualification, putting it in their CRM account, setting up their profile of the billing system.
Like I worked at this one place where they were using a very proprietary marketing integration where they would send out a personalized URL postcard or in an ad or something, and then you'd get to the landing page, and then they had like all these trees of things, but this sounds a lot better. Like, would it be doing the same kinds of things? Like if you answer yes to a question, does it automatically go to a survey page or a thank you if you said no or whatever? Can you have it doing that kind of things?
Not necessarily directing different pages, but sending the data to different
targets. Like, you know, if they responded yes to something, they get a page, but then maybe you get a text saying, hey, you've got a new contact, you should contact them.
Yes. I can have a trigger on here that would email me and say, the new contact came in. But I already have that on my gravity form. So, any other questions so far?
I got one more quick. Does it do deduping? You said or no?
It depends on the target.
Okay.
For example, I think Capsule CRM, I think it does it there.
Right, yeah, with the nodes. It's not Zapier itself.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. And one of the cool things, if you really want to get fancy, you can actually have a MySQL database set up. You could just pump data into that all day long using Zapier. So if you have a contacts table, if you have an invoice table, if you have a ticketing table or whatever, then you can use whatever interface you've built to read that data right out of MySQL. So.
This isn't necessarily tied to WordPress, correct, or is it?
Absolutely not. No. If you look at over here, I go back to Explore. Wufoo, for example. If I can use Wufoo on any platform, because I can, it gives me a snippet of code I can put in a web page, Facebook. And this works with social media too, so you can capture things from your Facebook page and transfer that in somewhere else and do something with it. So.
And who does Zapier?
It is
that company.
Yes. So just for kicks, let's just see Facebook pages. What can I do with Facebook pages? So let's see. I can create a post from a Facebook page entry. I could send something over to HipChat. I could send an email and something triggered in Facebook. And you can also kind of loop within the same application itself would do something. So you have posts from one Facebook page to another. I don't know who would do that, but good. So you get the idea. So in the next example, how are we doing on time? Are we okay?
7:55.
We should have 20 minutes. Okay. Trello. Who's heard of Trello? Trello is cool.
Yeah.
Trello check. Okay. So let me get into my Trello account. Change those. We got there. We got this. What about that? There. I use my Google account to authenticate into Trello, sorry. Trello, I'm learning a lot of things. So Trello is, how do I explain it? It's a place where you can create kind of like task management. So, or project management. So in this example, I've created a simple workflow for tickets, help tickets. Right? New ticket comes in. When I'm working on it, I transfer it to in progress and just drag and drop it over. If I'm waiting on the customer, I can drag it over there. It's a very simple workflow. It's not, by all means, an end-all solution for ticketing. But if you're a one-man show, you could do wonders with it. So what I'm going to do here is show you how I can take a form off of my website and create a ticket in Trello. So I'm going to go over to the website. Technical support. This is a WooFoo form. All right. So here I am going to go. Springfield, that was good power. New address, phone number, some required fields, so I got blast through here. I'll put mysite.com. Okay, next type of issue. I think my site has been hacked or is infected. Description of the issues, whatever. Dope. Can you provide admin access? Yeah, so this is just something I created. You can create your own thing. I'll assume you might need help as soon as possible. So when I click submit, it is going to fire this Zap over here. So my source is WooFoo, which is embedded in my website. My target is Trello, right? Create a card. So the concept of Trello is you have a board. Within a board, you have cards. Within the cards, you have tasks, comments, blah, 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 stuff. Okay? So I've set up my triggers. I've mapped my fields. You can get pretty complex with these. This is one big field that I've created. I can chat many things together, different fields. You'll see how that looks when I hit submit. Back to my web page, hit submit. All right, WooFoo has done its thing. Over here, there's my ticket. Open it up. Over Simpson, Springfield Power, everything that I've strung together in that field ends up over here. Now, as I even defined a checklist of things I want to do every time a ticket comes in, I can define those as well on my Zap. So here, again, because Zapier knows what Trello has for target fields, it lets you define things like labels, due date, file attachment, checklist name. I call it a checklist. I could call it to-do list, whatever I want. And then I just start adding them in here. So another one would be like, let's see, check for malware. Right? We have a junior person in your company that's doing antivirus work on your customer websites. You could have a checklist that helps them along until they get up to speed. Right? This is one way to do that. So what I ended up with in this example was this card. And then as I'm working, I could do activity. I did this, I did that, whatever. If I'm still working on it, I would move it over here in progress. Just, I'm not going to get into trouble too much, but you get the idea. So that's another example. Okay? Any questions so far? Okay. The last one I have is a CRM application called Capsule. Capsule is pretty cool. And there's a free level. Trello is totally free. They have an advanced level for business. You can look at the features, what they offer. Capsule has a free level as well. So let me go over to the Capsule. If you're in business and you need to have a workflow dealing with your clients, you know, sales process, you can define that in here. I'm not a Capsule guru, I'm learning it myself, but the concept is pretty much the same, people and companies and things you do with them. Okay. So in here, I have only one contact, and that's customer. So what I want to do is create another contact. And the way I do that, another way you look at it is I need to qualify a lead. So on my website, as an example, I have another form, a WooFo form, that's for consulting inquiries. Okay. So I fill this out real quick. Simpson, Greenfield, Power, 123 East Power Street, whatever. Springfield. This is probably wrong. I was put that. Former@gmail.com. I'll skip to the website. Do you know your requirements? Yes. I need development services, whatever. I'm just gonna come to things here. And then I hit submit. Yeah, I missed a required few comments. Oh, good. So, that. Alright. So, let's take a look at Zapier real quick. That integration, the dashboard. So here, WooFo is my source, and Capsule is my target, and I want to create a person, right? I've given it my WooFo credentials, my Capsule credentials. The trigger is my WooFo form called Consulting Inquiries, and I can see all my WooFo forms in here. It'll go over to WooFo and query all my forms in my particular account. And then I map my fields, right? These fields are what are in Capsule. So it's first name, last name, email, phone, yada, yada, yada. Right? And then you turn it on, give it a name, turn it on. Go over here. And let's see. Here we go. Google Citizen came over. And what's cool about Capsule is that it'll go out and query social media. So look at that. Homer Simpson is actually on Google Plus. So I can add his Google Plus profile on here. And then, jump over to the Simpsons. That's another third example. So there are just so many you can do. The trick is patience and just knowing how each side of the Zap works. You're sourcing your traffic. That's basically it. Any questions?
Just a quick one. With your first example, how you have the contact information, but then you had a freelance field, so they were selecting a job type and then giving a description of the work they needed. Can you pull that information, like you put it into your Google Contacts, but just the contact info, not the actual request?
Right.
Would you create a secondary Zap that could like grab the job request and then email you that information?
Yes.
And you just talk to the same form?
You can add additional fields in Google Contacts as well.
Yeah.
It wouldn't send it off to two different targets at the same time. You'd have to have them both trigger off the same one. So that one form, I could have three triggers, three Zaps.
Yeah.
One goes to Google Contacts, one goes to my CRM, one goes to Block.
Okay. That makes sense. So you just use the same webhook?
Yes.
To go with that. Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Hope that makes sense for everybody. Did you have a question?
Well, yeah, I tried to create a Zap for a new LinkedIn connection to a MailChimp subscriber, and it says the email is required, and then when I hit the insert field, it doesn't give email as a choice to insert that. Is there something about LinkedIn where it won't?
I haven't worked with that one yet, but I'll be happy to look at it.
Okay.
Now, before I forget, I called the good folks at Zapier and said, hey, I'm doing a demo. What you got? So they were kind enough to give us all 3 free months on their basic plan. When we get there, it doesn't help when you start the presentation. Go to that URL and type in AZWP. I'll leave that up. And you get 3 months. And the good thing about that is explore, try it out. Take your form, send the data over to different targets. And see if it's going to work for you.
Which is it?
Let's see. I'll come back to this in one second. So if you, let's see. Bryce. So I'm at the basic, so I can create 20 Zaps. So for me, that's all I need right now. They have a free one as well, with 5 Zaps. It runs every 15 minutes and 100 tasks a month. So a task is like a trigger. Mm-hmm. You do 100 and then that's all you get. For me, I'm just starting out, so 3,000 is sufficient enough for me. I needed more Zaps because I wanted to try different things, chain things together, so that's what I changed. But they're giving you 3 months on this plan here, the basic. So the same account that I'm using, I just showed you, you get 3 months, so give it a try. I tried to talk them into some swag, but they were out.
That was, so the people could see it, that'd be great. That was very cool. Thanks so much, Jeff. I mean, it's integrating with WordPress, but it actually has so many other possibilities besides WordPress about automation and making our life simpler. All right, so I'm showing that we are at 8:08, and we have a choice. I just heard some people say that they like to socialize and to network, and we could just break here and do that, or we could solicit someone who wanted to show off a website. What is the will of the group?
Networking.
Networking it is. Someone finally said it. All right, network. If anyone wants to hear about Gangplank, if you're new, is anyone new to Gangplank and doesn't know what this is? If you would like a tour and would like to hear a little bit about Gangplank, come meet me up here and I'll give you a quick tour around Gangplank. We have an organizers meeting, a WordPress meetup organizers meeting immediately following this. We'll probably be meeting about 30 or 45 minutes, maybe even a little bit longer.
anyone wanted to really hang out and wait for us, we'll probably be going out for some drinks after that, but we're going to be in a meeting for a little bit. So, again, the networking is at your will. We've got some key holders here at Gangplank that are going to be here, so I don't think anyone's getting kicked out quite yet. So I guess with that, please network with each other. If you're interested in hearing about Gangplank, come up here, and we'll see you next week or next month.
I'm going to go to the next one.
So, with those tools,
there's not any extra plug. It's, I think it's,
So you know what the name of that one guy was that was kind of tall and slender that was over here? He input some information.
The blog
one? But I don't want to break it.
Because I don't mind it.
So what I might do, and I'm sure I'm not going to do this, is to...
I know that if you lock it, do the same, it says, oh, check your name, and lock it, you have to extend it.
It's not a really
thing. Yeah, that's right. So.
That's
what I
I think that guy is the Arduino guy. I think he's the one that I talked to a lot.
But so anyway, this one's
got plugins, not WordPress, but plugins that help you, that can allow you to change the PHP or text on mobile device so that you can sort of PHP. I think there's
That's
because my designer came up with a site that just in the last few months. And he wanted a special page scroll, so I had to remain on the page scroll.
But I think it would be
someone just talking to me about today.
And that's all you guys first.
Really?
So, like I said,
it's a single page. I don't want to be able to take a page roadmap. I actually had to go back into the page. But he had fixed headers, so I had to. It took me 40 hours to get the logo set up correctly and
right? Because of how it extends down below. I had to create a loaf really funny. I had to do a really funny trick to cut it out because I had to lose some flavor. If you see it, you can see what I'm talking about. I had to, and it goes down below a certain amount, so I had to do an absolute position so that I could. I had to do an absolute position so that the header would get put into the geometry of everything below. Because if I didn't do that, then you wouldn't be able to click on the things below that header. Oh my god, it's light long.
Actually,
it's been fun. I needed to do what I did.
I'm just trying. I just need to throw it. Like I want to do. I think it's toxicstudios.com. I need a second domain just to point to my account. So I
gonna do that next?
Well, I was trying to get the cheapest one, and GoDaddy had them for like $2.99. I was afraid to buy it, .us. So I'm afraid if I buy it $2.99 next year, they would say, "Oh, now it's $19." Because if you do 1 year, it's $2.99.
Sorry, I'm sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
The only thing I've ever used is the PHP storage.
Right. That's the one thing that I really like the Postmaster. You guys are here.
So, we also have just a lot of fun stuff.
No, cool. Sorry.
For the
I think that might have worked us down here.
So, like, I
Basically, it's got one header, it's a scroll and the other thing. It's the same thing like that, but I noticed that the site manager, they have several different templates that were
I'm just wondering if so I can show you mostly in Brooklyn. Really. So the
way that I get it here. So I go into my recite.
You go into wherever.
That's my well actually you know what? That may be the only thing I do I go there is my recite. And the only thing I do is to check if you go to I don't use any of these stuff to get Okay, so that's for the main.
And again, this is only So you have books.
Thank you. Because I didn't, you know, I was just thinking about that yesterday. I think I want to go over and check out. So what I want to do, oh, okay, so there was the migration.
Yeah. So this is what the stream is like. Multiple sites.
Did I see you? Huh?
Did you
oh, shit.
So that's
still.